Hello students, today we have reached the third session of your chapter 1 of NCERT biological classification. So in last two sessions we have learnt about R.H. Whitaker's five kingdom system, how he did classify the organisms, on what character basis he did classify them into five different kingdoms, as well as in second session we have learnt about one kingdom, that is Monera. So today I will be introducing you to the second kingdom, that is Protista. So Protista, these include unicellular eukaryotic organisms. They include unicellular eukaryotic. So now when it comes to eukaryotic organisms, it means that they have a specified cell membrane, nuclear membrane, plus the organelles like mitochondria, Golgi complex, lysosomes, etc. do have a particular membranes which help in protecting them. So these are advanced when compared to kingdom Monera. These are aquatic organisms, that means they live most, if you see most of the examples which come under kingdom Protista, most of them occupy either the fresh water as well as marine water. Very few are terrestrial organisms. These are photosynthetic in nature, that means they have the ability to prepare their own food using the solar energy or sunlight. That is what is called photosynthetic. They have locomotory organs called flagella and cilia. Locomotory organs called flagella and cilia. Locomotory organs means these are the one which help in moving the organism from one place to another place, and the locomotory organs are termed flagella as well as cilia. When it comes to the reproduction, it takes place both asexually as well as sexually. The reproduction have two different forms: without involving gametes, that is by asexual reproduction, by or with the help of gametes, that is sexual reproduction. So reproduction normally have two different forms. Here it will be either through cell fusion, that is reproduction asexually, whereas zygote formation, that is for sexual reproduction. So here there are two different types: cell fusion, fusion of two different cells to form a new organism, that is what is asexual type of reproduction, whereas sexual involves zygote formation, that is when a male and female gametes fuse together, they form a zygote. So this will develop into a new organism. This is the mode of reproduction in case of Protista. This Protista is further divided into five different types. These are chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, euglenoids, slime molds, and the last one, that will be protozoans. So these are of five different types. Protista can be classified into chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, euglenoids, slime molds, and lastly protozoans. Now we will be studying about each of them in detail. So first coming to chrysophytes. In chrysophytes, they include diatoms. So you can call these are examples: diatoms, golden algae, these golden algae are also termed desmite. So it includes diatom as well as golden algae, which are also called desmites. When it comes to its habitat, these are fresh water as well as marine water. You can find them in sihiniralu nodadike sigutte, samudrada neeralu uppu neeralu nodadike sigutte. That means these are aquatic in general. It may be fresh water or it may be marine water. That is their habitat, both fresh water as well as marine one. These are microscopic planktons. Microscopic planktons. Planktons means these are aquatic minute microscopic organisms which have the ability to prepare their own food, that is using solar energy. That means what? These microscopic planktons are photosynthetic in nature. They have the ability to prepare their own food based on the solar energy. When it comes to diatoms, if you see, the diatoms have a structure of a box. That is the soap box. If you have seen a soap box, you can see they have a lid which is covered, and if you open that lid, you can place the soap within. So exactly same type. So outer layer is larger and inner layer will be smaller, just like a soap box. So this membrane or the outer layer of diatoms, it is made up of silica. Silica is a particular component or a material which is indestructible. That means it cannot be destroyed. It stays in the earth's surface for millions or billions of years to gather. To identify whether the diatoms were present in which era of the beginning of the earth, we have identified that we have got this diatoms billions of years together. How did we identify that they were present billions of years together? Is just because of deposition of silica which was present in the earth surface. So here in diatoms you can see that they have two overlapping shells. These overlapping shells are made up of silica, which is indestructible and can be available even after billions of years to gather because it cannot be destroyed. Next one is uses of this diatoms. So the soil which is rich in diatoms can be used in filtration purpose as well as purification. Purification of oils as well as syrup can be used. The soil which is rich in diatoms can be used for filtration purpose or else for purification of oil as well as syrups. If you see here, diatoms are the one which are the chief producers. These are the ones which produce energy and transfer it into the consumers. So here in ocean, diatoms form the main and chief producers. So in together, if you see in chrysophytes, chrysophytes are having diatoms, golden algae or desmites as an example. These are microscopic planktons which are photosynthetic in nature. These are, or these have a habitat of fresh water as well as marine water. When it comes to the structure of the diatoms, these are made up of two overlapping shells made of silica, and once you can dig the earth, you can get this silica from bottom layers of soil. So that is why in that particular area it is termed diatomaceous earth, because there in that particular layer of soil the amount of silica is very much high. When it comes to the silica, as I've told you, it is indestructible. That is why it is easily available even now in the earth surface. A handful of soil which contains large amount of diatoms can be used in filtration as well as purification of oils as well as syrups. Plus, diatoms are the one which are the chief producers in case of oceans. So that's about the chrysophytes. Next is dinoflagellates. So dinoflagellates are marine in nature. That means they are purely restricted to only oceans. These are also photosynthetic in nature. That means using solar energy, they can prepare their own. These have different colors like green, yellow, blue, brown, even red can also be included here, red, etc. So in together, these are made up of different colors. Why is it? Is purely based on the pigment which is present in their body. So the pigment which is present in their body gives them different colors. When it comes to the outer cell wall or the protective layer, it is made up of cellulose, cellulosic cell wall. It has a cellulosic cell wall, And here, as the name suggests, dinoflagellates. These are locomotory in function. That means they have the ability of locomotion using flagella. Flagella helps in locomotion. But there are two different types of flagella. One is longitudinal. Another is transverse. So there, if the organism is like this, there is a longitudinal as well as transverse type of flagella which helps in moving in different direction. When it comes to the location of the flagella, these are present in the furrow. Furrow anta heladre depression anta artha. For example, ivaga cell wall ee tara idre. If this is the cell wall, you can see here this particular part, the middle part is a furrow, andre depression tara irutte. So in between these depressions you can find the placement of this flagella. So here longitudinal and transverse flagellas both are present in the furrows of the cell plate. The location will be in the furrow of the cell plate. So there are two different types of flagella which helps in moving in different direction, that will be longitudinal as well as transverse. When it comes to example, so example will be goniolex or red dinoflagellates. So this red dinoflagellates are restricted more in the ocean. If they multiply means they increase their number or reproduce themselves and produce high number of red dinoflagellates, the water or the tides which beats to the seashore will be having red color because of increased number of this red dinoflagellates. This, if increased more than required, it releases a toxic substance which may be quite damaging to the aquatic organisms which are present in the oceans. So that is about dinoflagellates. Dinoflagellates are microscopic organisms. These are photosynthetic in nature. They are restricted to marine water. They have different colored organisms, or they are of different colors because or purely based on the pigment which is present in their body. Their cell wall is made up of cellulose. They have flagellas for locomotion. There are two types of flagella. One is longitudinal, one is transverse, which are located in the furrow of the cell plate. Here example you can take guanolex, or it is commonly called red dinoflagellates. So if their number is more in the marine region, you can find the tides being red colored. But still, if their numbers increases more than required, they release a toxic substance which might be quite damaging to the aquatic organisms. So that's about dinoflagellates. Third is euglenoids. Euglenoids are restricted to stagnant water. Stagnant water andre ninta neerali you can find more number of euglenoids. Next, coming to their outer surface, here they do not have a proper cell wall. Instead, they have a protective layer which is made up of protein protective layer, and that name is called pellicle. So the protein layer is termed pellicle. This pellicle is more flexible compared to the cellulosic cell wall. Silica cell wall agirbodu athwa cellulosic cell wall compare madidre, this proteinaceous cell wall, that is pellicle, is much more flexible. Here in case of euglenoids, they also have locomotion, that is movement. Here also they have flagella. Just like dinoflagellates, here the flagella are also of two different types. One is long, another is short. Here the mode of nutrition, these are of two different types: photosynthetic under favorable condition. That means on a sunny day, the euglenoids will be showing photosynthetic type of mode of nutrition because they have similar pigments as that which are present in higher plants. when it comes to a cloudy day or when the sunlight availability is very less, they suddenly turn themselves into heterotrophs. In case of heterotrophs, what it means is they depend, or the nutrition which will be extracted or taken from other organisms. They consume smaller organisms to attain the nutrition what they require. Example for euglenoids, it is Euglena. Euglena can be taken as an example for euglenoids. To revise once again, euglenoids, they are restricted to stagnant water. They have no proper cell wall. Instead, they have a protective layer called proteinaceous cell wall, which is called pellicel, which is much more flexible compared to the cellulosic or silica cell walls. Flagella, they are helping or helpful in locomotion. They are of two different types, long and short. When it comes to the mode of nutrition, they are photosynthetic in the availability of sunlight. They get turned into heterotrophs in the absence of sunlight. Example for this will be Euglena. Next one is slime molds. These are the type of protista which are saprophytic. That means they feed on dead and decaying organisms. They purely depend on, they move easily towards or between the dead leaves or decaying leaves. They draw the nutrition or organic matter from that so that their nutrition requirement will be satisfied. Whenever a suitable environmental condition is provided, these slime molds aggregate to form a structure called plasmodium. So molds will be like this. Whenever favorable conditions are available, these molds will start to aggregate, come together, they form plasmodium. When the slime molds get suitable condition, they come together, aggregate to form plasmodium. This plasmodium, under unfavorable condition, produce fruiting bodies and disperse spores. From the spores, it gives rise to a new slime mold. Here the spores are present in such a way that they have a very hard, proper, complete protective structure which is present outside their surface, and they can survive or tolerate any type of environmental condition, and this can be, or the spores can be retained many years together without getting damaged because of its protective outer layer. So that's about slime molds. These are saprophytic in nature, depend on the organic matter taken from the dead or decaying leaves or organisms. When they have a suitable environment, they form a structure called plasmodium, and this plasmodium, under unfavorable condition, produces fruiting body which releases spores which have a protective layer and can survive for many years together. When the favorable condition comes, the spores outer layer breaks to give rise to a new slime mold. Last one, that will be protozoans. Protozoans, based on their locomotory ability, it can be classified into different types. So the last one is protozoan. Protozoans are purely heterotrophs. They are not autotrophs, purely heterotrophs. They might be predaceous. That means they consume other organisms, or parasitic. They depend on other organisms for nutrition. Protozoans can be termed as primitive forms of animals. As I have told, based on their locomotory ability, they can be classified into four different types. First one is amoeboids. So amoeboid, just like amoeba, here amoeboids, they have a particular type of locomotory organ that is called pseudopodia. Pseudopodia are small finger-like projection which keep on tapping, which keep on moving like this, because of which one the organism can move forward. Example for this will be Entamoeba is one of the example for amoeboid type of protozoa. These pseudopodia can also be termed false feet. And some of the marine type of amoeboid organisms, these have silica as their outer protective covering. Next one is flagellated. When it comes to flagellated, these are free living parasitic and their locomotory organ will be flagella, and some of the parasite causes disease called sleeping sickness. An example for this will be trypanosoma. Next one is ciliated. Here the locomotory or this aquatic organism have locomotion with the help of small finger like projection which is spread throughout their body, that is called cilia. Here also the cilia keeps on moving and helps in pushing the food back into the stomach. Here the stomach is nothing but gullet. So here cilia is the locomotory organ. An example for this will be paramecium. Paramecium is one of the example for ciliated type of locomotory organ, which is a part or type of protozoan. Last one will be, so here organisms which involve a spore like stage in their life cycle come under sporozoans, and the disease is malaria. An example for this will be Plasmodium. So here these are the four different types of protozoans, that is amoeboid, flagellated, ciliated and sporozoans. Amoeboids have false feet called pseudopodia, example is Entamoeba, whereas flagellated have flagella. Some of the parasites cause sleeping sickness disease, example is Trypanosoma. Ciliated have cilia throughout their body which helps in pushing the food and locomotion, in case of example Paramecium. And sporozoans, these have spore-like stage in their life cycle. Example will be Plasmodium, which causes a disease in human beings, that is malaria. So that's about different types of protistas involving chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, euglenoids, slime molds, as well as protozoans. So here in today's class, we have got the rough idea about Kingdom Protista and a complete idea about different types of organisms which are involved in Protista. Chrysophytes involving diatoms as well as some of the golden algae, dinoflagellates involving red dinoflagellates, euglenoids involving euglenas. When it comes to slime molds, we have studied the saprophytic nature of slime molds and protozoan with four different types based on their locomotory organs. So that's all for today's class. Next class we'll be studying about the third kingdom, that is Mycota. Thank you.